Hello, I'm Colin Hurwitz, and you're listening to WITZ, The Wits, the one place for all things music, art, performance, and entertainment right here in Douglas County, Oregon. We have a lot of great sponsors for this show, and we're really grateful. Let's start with our first with 10 Down Bowling and Splits Bar and Grill. Thank you so much for being a great sponsor these last 8 months. We really do appreciate it. And of course, New Visions Eye Care for your spectacle needs, Edward Jones for your investment needs, our new sponsor, Wix Emmett, for all of your CPA needs, and of course, we're always grateful for Spider King Studios, the Gene Bechtel School for Music, and the Douglas County Music Association. Let me tell you a little bit about where your money goes when you donate to the nonprofit, the Douglas County Music Association. If you'd like to be a bronze tier member, $200 will ensure that we have studio space and teachers for students to learn. $500 will put you in the silver tier. Now, if you donate $500, you can see one of our Gene Bechtel School teachers for quite a while. We'll work it out between you and me when we start figuring out how much you want to donate. But if you donate $500, you'll be a silver tier member, and you'll get to see one of our teachers, and we'll work that out. $1,000 will make you one of our gold tier members, and you will get priority access to shows, your choice seating, shirts, t-shirts, hats, whatever we come up with. And of course, you can select several members of your family to receive lessons from myself or some of the Gene Bechtel staff or any teacher in town, really. Just we'll orchestrate all of that once you want to talk more about donations. But we're really looking forward to your sponsorship for our nonprofit. We need your help to provide all of these opportunities for performers, students, anybody in Douglas County that wants to be a musician, an artist, or performer of any caliber. So please consider donating to the nonprofit today, signing up and being part of our tier membership list. If you want to send an email and ask us a few questions, you can send an email to OregonDCMA@gmail.com. And of course, if you're ready to donate now, which we're really grateful for, by the way, you can go to Venmo and you can search at OregonDCMA and you can donate anything that you want. If you do donate and we see your name, you will get a shout out on the broadcast. But like I told you guys last week, this is the final episode of season one of the WITZ, and I'm telling you that today's show is going to be spectacular. It'll be a little longer than normal, but that's okay. You can always skip portions you don't like. You can skip straight to the guest performance. You can go straight to the DCMA concert. You can just go straight to the interview or just don't watch the show at all. We would like you to watch the show, though. It'd be great if you watched the show, because what's the point of making a show if nobody's going to watch it? You make a good point. I'm glad I brought it up. But that being said, all of you are so important. Anything that you donate to the nonprofit can and will be used to support Douglas County musicians, artists, dancers, you name it, anybody out there. So please consider donating today. I'd also like to remind you that the Douglas County Music Association website is underway. My friend, or my brother-in-law, Alex, and I are working together to get that done for you, and it should be up by the end of this summer. And we're excited to start a membership program where you can sign up and receive bonuses and benefits. And of course, when season two of The Wit starts later this summer, hopefully our model and our infrastructure will be more elevated, doing some more complicated procedures, having different segments with different people, and a lot more diversity on the show. So I'm excited to start season two of The Wits, but without further ado, let's get to this week's final episode of the WITZ. And now for some old news. This week I'm not doing old news. This week I'm actually going to only feature a couple of things. We have our guest Dan Smaha on the list, and he's going to do a great job. I'm looking forward to seeing him on the program later today. But I'm not going to review old news, and I'm actually not going to talk about current events this week either. I'm just going to let you know that this is the final episode of The Wits for a while, and if you haven't joined our Facebook page, I really recommend that you do. There isn't a day that goes by where some event, poster, or flyer isn't posted. I mean, almost every single day I see new flyers for new events, the brewfests and festivals and carnivals and music shows and stuff at Sutherland and Oakland and wine houses. And so the Douglas County Music Association Facebook page is literally doing exactly what I wanted it to do. A central safe haven for all performers to let everyone know what they're up to, what shows are going on, where is live music happening, what festivals. So please continue to use the Facebook page to get all of your information regarding Douglas County music. And again, if you're in Camas Valley or 10 Mile, or if you're as far south as Myrtle Creek or Oakland, join our Facebook page and put everything there. Anything and everything in Douglas County that's going on should be there. And of course, every time anything is posted, put it on your calendar, come to the show. If you liked the show, you can send us an email, because sometimes I can't make every single show. Well, you'd be surprised how often I can't make shows. But if you go and you have a review, you should certainly let us know. Send an email to OregonDCMA@gmail.com. Let us know, or comment on a video. Say, I went to that show. It was awesome, or it was terrible, or whatever. Whatever works for you. Just let us know how the shows go, because this whole network is all about you and the music and the art and the performance right here in Douglas County, Oregon. So please consider.
And now it's time for some reviews.
All right. This is the main portion of the broadcast portion of the show, so I'm just going to get right to it. I want to say thank you. These are all the people who have donated from Venmo in the last 8 months. So Mario Rodriguez, thank you so much. Kelly Williams Ponto. Now, those two donated after they saw the DCMA concert on June 2nd, so thank you, both of you. Rosa Molzik also donated. Thank you, Rosa. Actually, one of my colleagues at school. Eric Schnautz, a friend of the show, who's also with Face for Radio, has donated to the program. That was for Dr. Wheeler's fundraiser. And, of course, Candace Hurwitz, my sister-in-law. I like the New York pronunciation. You're just going to have to get used to it. But Candace also donated to help with Dr. Wheeler's program, so thank you all of you for donating on Venmo. Checks from the Grand Piano Concert, the Shepherd Living Trust gave, Kieta Lee also gave, and David and Jean Snyder gave, so thank you very much to those families who donated to the DCMA after our piano concert. And we want to get a big thank you for all of these artists who have either been featured on the program, talked about on the program, or have been on the program, so a big thank you to Widespread Haze. I have to say it like that. Face for Radio, Cover Culture, Rovers and Dragons, the solution to all your problems, the Sunny Sky Boys, the fabulous Del Montes Brothers, Colleen and Company featuring Bruce Gordon, Dr. Jason Heald, and the Umpqua Singers, Peter Lalonde and Holly Snyder. They were the leads from the Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat show, and they did a great job. Gavin Pike, my man, one of my favorite human beings on the planet. Taylor Seiling, one of our nonprofit board members. Michael Mendenhall, Trevor Thompson and the UCC bands, both of them. Trevor, you're doing a great job. Izzy Trinkle, thanks for coming on the show. Tori Rose, one of our favorites. Camille Smicker, Samantha Starnes, Stacey Atwell Keister, Sean Shea, Brianna J.L. Graves, thank you all so much for being on the show or being involved in the broadcast. Corey Peachy Briggs was one of our first guests on the show, besides, of course, Miss Ariel Hicks. Thank you for being a co-host, and thank you for being on the show as well. Kim Eichmann, Mr. Jake Tranter with Spider King Studios, Master Catherine Kearns, one of our other first guests on a musical instrument, Dr. Michael Wheeler, thank you for hosting the event, the Hughcrest Community Choir, and, of course, Julianne Shepherd and Sira Magnani. Thank you all so much for being on the broadcast. We couldn't have done it, literally, without you. So thank you so much. And my final review of the first season of the WITZ, in my opinion, and you don't have to agree with me, I would say it was a smash hit. I was really thrilled with the work that we all did. There were some ups and some downs. We created some weird guests like Winter Storm and Heat Way, or I think it was Summer Heat or something like that. I can't remember. But we had some interesting created guests for the show when things went awry. We had some logistical issues, some technical issues. Some shows didn't get uploaded on time because of some failures in the system. And also some equipment didn't work. Some equipment got lost. And of course, we had our awesome break-in that was really fun. So, you know, through thick and thin, through for lack of a better term, through the sleet, the hail, and the snow, we persevered. We gave you 34 episodes of the WITZ, one episode a week for the last, 34 weeks? Or actually, would it really be 34 weeks? 34 episodes once a week? That's incredible. Now that I think about it, that's kind of amazing. Wow, incredible. So I can't wait to get started on our next season. We're going to take a little hiatus. I need some time off. I'm going to go lay in my hammock for about a month, and I'm not going to move. It's going to be great. I'll probably eat some pizza while I'm at it, too. So all of you out there, we really appreciate you listeners. We'll end today's broadcast with a broadcast. What is a broadcast? Well, think about it. Think about it. It's going to be the three of us, the trifecta, the Spider King, Gene Bechtel, and myself. We're going to have a fun conversation about what we're doing up next. So thank you so much for everybody for watching our show. And let's get to our guests. Here we go.
When I was invited to come and be on Colin Hurwitz's Douglas County Music Association's podcast, I was kind of taken aback, actually. You know, what do I have to offer? You know, I'm just a simple country boy. I play a homemade guitar. I sing simple songs. But I have had a great deal of enjoyment with my musical career And I really didn't start singing seriously till I was 19 years old and didn't pick up the guitar till I was 22. So in the words of my favorite Indian, Dougie Hall, he says, if you like what I do, go ahead and use it. If you don't worry about it. Now this is a song I learned 64 years ago, way before I ever thought that I would ever sing before any kind of an audience anywhere, long before I would ever pick up the guitar. And I was taught by my grade school musical educator, Miss Constance Cruikshank, who had the same job that Colin Hurwitz has at Hughcrest School, and she taught kindergarten through sixth grade. And she made me learn this song, and I hated it. I truly hated this song. And then later in my life, I lived it, every aspect of it. I'm not gonna sing the whole song. I'm just gonna sing the verses that mean the most to me. And in my life, I incorporated this into my little act, and I would always start my programs with this song because I'm a patriot, I'm a God-fearing American. I love the United States of America. I've traveled this country, and this song by Woody Guthrie just nailed it. And so I want to sing for you, and go ahead and sing along, if you know it. And I'm thinking anybody over 50 is gonna know this song. This land is your land, this land is my land, from California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me. As I was walking that ribbon of highway, I saw above me that endless skyway, saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me. This land is your land, this land is my land, from California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me. I've roamed and rambled, and I followed her footsteps to the sparkling sands of her diamond desert. And all around me, a voice was sounding. This land was made for you and me. This land is your land, this land is my land, from California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me. And the sun comes shining as I was strolling, and the wheat fields waving, and the dark clouds rolling. As the fog was lifting, a voice was chanting. This land was made for you and me. This land is your land, this land is my land, from California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. Yes, this land was made for you and me. Yeah, this land was made for you and me. You and me, you and me. Oftentimes I find myself in a situation where I don't have Esther Bell. This is my girlfriend, my mistress, Esther Bell. And by the way, not for sale. But still you can sing your songs. You know, I think that's what I'm trying to get across. My presentation is to give many of you that are listening to this podcast that, you know, maybe you're not a top professional musician, maybe you just want to have some fun, that you can have fun with music anytime. I told you I learned that first song 64 years ago. Well, I picked other ones up along the way, and this is one that my daughter and I sing as a duet. I'll just give it to you solo, and I'll give it to you a cappella. And this is dedicated to all of those immigrants that came into this great country of America and just wanted to have a job and have an honest day's pay. It's called Dear Boss, dedicated to my Irish friends. Dear boss, I write this note to you to tell you of me plight. And at the time of writing, I am not a pretty sight. Me body is all black and blue, me face a deadly gray. I'm writing to explain why Patty's not at work today. I was working on the 14th floor, some bricks I had to clear. Throwing them down from such a height was not a good idea. The foreman wasn't pleasant, he being a dreadful sod. He said that I must pack them down the ladder in me hod. Now clearing all these bricks by hand, it was a dreadful slow. I hoisted up a barrel and secured a rope below. But in me haste to do the job, I was too blind to see that a barrel full of building bricks was heavier than me. Now I climbed down and I cut the rope. The barrel fell like lead. Clinging tightly to the rope, I started up instead. I shot up like a rocket, and to my surprise I found halfway up I met the bloody barrel coming down. Now the barrel struck me shoulders, toward the ground it sped. When I reached the top, I hit the pulley with me head. I spun around all stunned and shocked by this almighty blow, while the barrel dumped out all the bricks 14 floors below. Now when the bricks had spilled from the barrel to the ground, I then outweighed the barrel and I started down once more. Still clinging tightly to the rope, I headed for the ground, landed on the building bricks scattered all around. Now as I lay there on the floor, I thought I'd passed the worst. When the barrel hit the pulley and then the bottom burst, a shower of bricks rained down on me. I hadn't got a hope. And as I was losing consciousness, let go the bloody rope. Now the barrel being heavier, it started down once more, struck across me smartly as I lay upon the floor. It broke four ribs in my left arm, and all that I can say is I hope you'll understand why Patty's not at work today.
Sometimes a song will mean one thing to you for a certain part of your life, and then it'll mean another thing to you. And I learned this song from a very, very popular artist in the late 60s and early 70s. And I think he was one of the most understated, underappreciated crossover artists out there, John Denver. John Denver also was a pilot, and I am a pilot. One-eyed, you know, half blind, half deaf pilot. And I had a very good, and I would sing Take Me Home Country Roads, because I was this cowboy and I did travel around, and always the country roads, the sand hills of western Nebraska would call me home. And I had a friend who, he got his check ride for his, he owned a beautiful Piper Aztec. Got his instrument rating on Friday night, and he flew the airplane straight into the ground on Monday morning with his dad on board in a blizzard in western Nebraska. And his widow came to me and asked me if I would play music for his funeral, and the song that she wanted was Take Me Home Country Roads. So this song has never meant the same to me as it did when I first started, but it still means a lot to me. And when I do my little program for veterinarians associations, the Nebraska Fine Arts Council, I even got to do that one time when their big player name guy got snowed out and couldn't get to town. And so they threw in the second team. Take Me Home Country Roads reminds me of my home in western Nebraska, reminds me of my friends, and reminds me of how quick your life can be snatched away from you in a heartbeat. And songs mean different things to different people at different times in their life. And I end every program that I do with Take Me Home Country Roads in a tribute to John Denver, who also died in an airplane crash.
Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountain, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze. Country roads,
take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia, mountain mama, take me home, country roads. All my memories gather round her, miner's lady, stranger to blue water. Dark and dusty, painted on the sky, misty taste of moonshine, teardrop in my eye. Country roads, take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia, mountain mama, take me home, country roads. I hear her voice in the morning hour, she calls me. Radio reminds me of my home far away. And riding down the road, I get a feeling that I should have been home yesterday. Yesterday, country roads, now take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia, mountain mama, take me home, country road. Take me home, now country road.
Moving along in my career, when I did finally learn to play the guitar a little bit and start singing, I heard a cowboy poetry group called the Bard and the Balladeer, and they sang this song. Well, the balladeer, he actually played this song, and it was a poem written by Charles Badger Clark, who was the poet laureate of South Dakota. Now, I am a cowboy actually out of Nebraska. I may not look it, but I got more miles horseback than, if you're not an endurance rider, I got a lot of miles. I made my living off of a horse. And again, I live this song. This is a Charles Badger Clark wrote this. It's called Just Riding. And the guitar arrangement is mine. This is my own arrangement. And I play it on my homemade guitar. A friend of mine made this. Bill Peterson made this in his garage in Grand Island, Nebraska, this guitar. And I think he did a really nice job. He was making them for the big boys down in Nashville. And my friend Billy passed away a year ago. And so I've had this guitar for almost 40 years. It's a friend of mine. Just Riding. And again, I've lived every bit of this song.
Well, there's them that like the city, grass that's curried smooth and green, theaters strangling collars, wagons run by gasoline. But for me, it's horse and saddle, every day without a change, and the desert sun ablazing on 100 miles of rain. Riding, just riding, desert rippling in the sun. Mountain blue along the skyline, I don't envy anyone when I'm riding. When my feet is in the stirrups and my horse is on the bus and his hooves flashing lightning from a golden cloud of dust, and the bawling of the cattle is a coming down the wind, then a finer life than riding would be mighty hard to find. Riding, just riding, splitting long cracks through the air, stirring up a baby cyclone, ripping up the prickly pear as he's riding. I don't need your art exhibits when the sunset does her best, painting everlasting glory on the mountains to the west. And your opera seems foolish when the nightbird starts a tune and the desert silver painted from the touches of the moon. Riding, just riding, who could envy kings or czars? when those coyotes down the valley start singing to the star as he's riding. This is the sad verse. Now when my earthly trail is ended and my final bacon curl and the last great roundup's ended at the home ranch of the world, I don't want no harps, no halos, robes, nor other dressed up things. Just let me ride that starry range on a pinto horse with wings. Riding, just riding, nothing I'd like half so well as a rounding up the sinners that have wandered out of hell and a riding. Riding, just riding, desert rippling in the sun. Mountains blue along the skyline. I don't envy anyone when I'm riding. Who could envy anyone when they're riding?
Hey. And hi, everybody. It is my distinct honor and privilege to welcome to the program Mr. Dan Smaha. Dan, welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course. Dan, for the audience who doesn't know, now, I was actually just saying this a minute ago, but I'll say it again. Now, the Dos Equis commercials say that they happen to know the most interesting man in the world. I think they're full of it. I actually happen to be sitting next to the most interesting man in the world right here. And for the audience who doesn't know, Mr. Dan, will you please just highlight some of your fabulous features that makes you very interesting, especially something that you and I have talked about, and I've had you at my school a couple of times. You're a very interesting person, Dan. Let's hear some of the specs.
Well, first of all, I never read my own headlines.
Right.
Ever. You know, and any type of musical program that I do, it is really truly not about me. It's always about the people I interact with and my audiences and my friends.
Right.
And but I will tell you that we were joking before the show that I am, my attributes are I'm half blind, I'm deaf, I'm a little bit crippled up, but other than that, I have a lot going on. I have had I'm the most blessed man you know, but I have, I've been most of the way around the world. You know, I never was in the military, so I've done it on my own dime. I've traveled early in my life. I still ride a motorcycle I bought when I was 19 years old, and I have it still, and my wife and I ride it, and I have ridden every state west of the Mississippi, up into Canada, down into Mexico. I have my own agribusiness. I am truly, as I mentioned, a cowboy. I have a lot of miles horseback. I've had many, many adventures. I'm a pilot. I'm a certified scuba diver. I've flown back and forth across the country. I've owned my third airplane that I've owned, and Mr. Ow. Colin has flown with me 10 times now.
And
roughly.
That's even knowing that he was half blind and half deaf. I was like, you know what, let's go.
He still went.
One of the most competent pilots I've ever met.
And so. I just wanted to share that he did not scream too loudly.
I screamed a little bit.
The first time that we took off, he'd flown in military transports. This man, there's more to him than meets the eye.
He took off the side of a mountain. It's not very normal.
Yeah, I did. And so I just simply took off and I went to pull in a chandelle, which is a climbing turn. And he went, he didn't scream loudly,
I made a noise.
So a pilot and well-traveled and music has been, I speak many languages.
Yes.
I speak a little Espanol, but I speak music. And music has been my universal language that has made me friends. Literally all the way around, on
now,
three different continents.
And again, the audience is just getting to know you. The audience has known me for these last 34 episodes. Can you believe that? But the audience knows me pretty well because I've said a lot. But how did we meet? Could you please tell the audience how you and I got in touch? It's a really interesting story.
Well, the very first time I ever laid eyes on Colin Hurwitz was that when he married his beautiful wife, Missy Aiken. Mm-hmm. And Colin's wife and my youngest daughter were very, very good friends, so we attended the wedding. And when he showed up at the wedding, it was an outdoor venue on the Aiken Ranch.
Yep.
And when I walked in there, as I mentioned, I was not in the military, but I have a deep respect for the military.
Didn't you have family in the military?
My father was second wave in at Normandy.
There you go.
And he fought as a recon ranger through the duration.
So you would be an honorary Marine, in my opinion.
Well, the people that I hunted and fished with, the only ones that could keep up with me were Marines.
Right. So he's a harder charger than they
are. Fighting or doing anything, but the only ones that could keep up with me shooting and fighting were Marines.
Yep.
So we walk into the venue, and there's all these Marines in dress blues, which I'm just like, what? And then Colin was not in dress blues, nope. but he's a Marine, you know? And so I just went, wow, I don't know him, but he was a 4-year Marine combat drummer.
And, it's true.
He sends a...
Sending eight notes downrange.
Downrange. Yeah. And so I like that. And then later, we ended up, we play in a praise band for North Umpqua Bible Fellowship. Yeah. And he's a drummer and I simply am a backup singer. Which, ironically, I vowed I would never be in another church choir as long as I lived.
No, why wouldn't you want to be in a church choir? Did you have a bad experience with that?
I did. Which you can. You can have bad experience with music. Mm-hmm. You can. But never say never.
Right.
I am enjoying singing with young people in our praise band, and Colin is there, and we started to develop a friendship from there. And I'm older than his parents, but he's like my brother. He's like my son I never had.
Oh. No, I have to say that the feeling is mutual, Mr. Dan. It's quite true. So we met basically at church. That's pretty spot on. But you've been all over the place. Where in the country haven't you gone? Is there anywhere in the United States you haven't been?
Well, in the words of Tel Sackett from Louis L'Amour, you know, he said, Tel Sackett said, the meek ain't gonna hear nothing west of the Mississippi. So I've only concentrated on west of the Mississippi, but I have been to New York, and I've been to Chicago, and I've been to Michigan, and I have traveled around. I haven't made it to all of the 50 continental United States, but I've been to Alaska, and I've been to Hawaii.
Right.
And so I've covered the United States of America. I've been on the East Coast. I've thrown a cast net in Tampa Bay. Scuba dived, snorkeled in the ocean.
Now, you said you're originally from Nebraska, right?
Yeah.
How often do you go back there? And
well, I go back there often. My family, I would go back often. Okay, my wife and I emigrated to Oregon in 1999, so we have actually lived over half our married life. And by the way, I want to say right up front, the most important musical gig I ever had, the most significant one that affected my life the most was I got my wife because of my music. Oh yes. Oh yes, all you young people that are watching this, it works, you know.
Yeah, it's, you know, we complain about the kids these days don't want to do anything. And this is a consistent story we have on the Wits broadcast. Almost every single time we have a guest, we ask, why did you get into music? And they always say, to meet people. I wanted to get into music to meet girls. I wanted to get into music to meet people and find a romantic partner. And so for all of you out there that are like, well, I shouldn't even bother with music. I don't know. Here's an example. You never know what music or your art may get. You might be dancing on stage and see the love of your life in the audience. You just never know. Or you could be working with them backstage. It's all a mystery. But your wife doesn't play music, does she?
Oh, no. She's a trained musician. She plays keyboard. She was a trained flutist, and she sang in a touring concert choir in high school. Mm. And in fact, my wife and I played together. We sang duets. We did 13 weddings one year. Mm. And she and I have entertained all around Western Nebraska and several states.
And you have a family band, like your whole family plays music.
Yes, but we don't have a band. I always just play the guitar and then we all primarily concentrate on our vocals.
Right.
But my wife was a career educator and she contracted, she was an English teacher and she spoke and read all the time and she has some nodules. So the doctor told her, you know, you can either sing or you can talk. You may lose your voice if you continue to try to sing. And so, sadly, on occasion, I can get her to step up and we still have some very, very, very cute duets that we do. But I won my wife because of my ability to play music, and the first thing she heard was my voice coming over the top of a choir loft in the United Church of Scotland, which is the Presbyterian Church in Alliance, Nebraska, in 1980.
Now, you and I have talked offset about a couple of things regarding your performance history. What kinds of shows do you like to do? You and I have talked about how you mostly like to kind of keep your music in-house within friends and family, but you've also said you do other kinds of gigs. You've told me that you played, I can't remember where it was. Can you tell the audience and me what kinds of gigs you like to play, or if any at all?
Okay. Well, ironically,
besides this, of course,
if you want to know where I've made the most money, the most money I've made is singing for weddings and singing for funerals. I was
too happy.
I know you think that
happy singing, and sad occasions.
You'd think that being a funeral singer, but remember, I come from Western Nebraska, from an area where I knew 5,000 people on a first name basis. Ooh. I still do back in 1,498 miles straight east of Roseburg is the town of Alliance, Nebraska, and the western edge of the largest sand dune area in the Western Hemisphere, in Box Butte County, Nebraska. It's 3,940 feet high plains, and the wind blows all the time. The coldest day I ever spent outside with my cattle was 35 degrees below zero, and the wind chill was 72 below zero. And I was out all day. I got little frozen ears, little frozen fingers, little frozen nose, frozen toes, but that's...
You might like our friend Winter Storm. We had him on the program twice. You remember, did you see that episode?
Not Winter Storm. No.
So we got snowed in three times here in Oregon, and I couldn't get into the studio, and my guest Kim Eichmann got canceled three times, and so we brought Winter Storm on the program, but I can feel that cold.
Yeah.
It feels unreal. You said 72 below zero wind chill?
72 degrees below zero wind chill, yeah.
No thanks.
No thanks to me. I did it. I got the t-shirt. I have moved on.
You should have worn it on the show.
So back to the question.
Please.
What was the question?
I was curious about what kind of venues you'd play
for.
Yes.
Okay. So.
This happens, folks.
So.
It's all good.
So, but my absolute favorite venue is a campfire on the High Plains or on the coast of Oregon, with a bunch of my daughter's horse camping buddies.
Nice.
And me with my guitar, sitting around the campfire and having people join in and sing. And to me, it just doesn't get any better than that.
Didn't you play something at Safe Haven recently, though? Or you play for like a Calgary somewhere? Besides our church, you play for...
I run the chapel service. Well, I say I run. I do. I run the chapel service for the Roseburg Men's Homeless Shelter on the third Friday, which will be this Friday night.
Ooh, so you might want to put that on the show, actually.
I do that, and when I was interviewed by the powers that be, my friends, John, and that talked to me about my program, I said, yes, I will preach. I'm not a preacher, but I I love Jesus. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. And I refer to my Bible, and I do preach from the Bible, but I incorporate stories, one about one of my favorite musicians, and I do play music because I want to try to catch those men's attention. And I will tell you, you haven't lived until you've sat in front of my Bible and my guitar and me in front of somewhere between 35 to 55 men who are sitting in the audience who don't want to be there.
Right.
That's compulsory chapel service, which to me is very positive.
But you managed.
At the Roseburg.
You managed to capture their attention and keep their focusing.
Yes. And so, I do that. And I've committed to do that every third Friday for as long as I can.
So you might want to, so where is that actually? Where is
the Roseburg Mission down on Felony Flats. And it is, leave your guns at home, leave your knives, leave your pepper spray. You come in there and
Sorry,
you sit
guys.
Among people, and it is sobering. No pun intended. It is something.
So,
you know, and friends have asked me, why don't you record that? And I said, no, it's entirely too private.
Right. So actually, you and I have talked about this, about like music as not only a form of entertainment, but also a form of service. And that we also have talked about functional music, where music doesn't, there are some schools of mind, and hear me out on this, some schools of mind would say that music serves no purpose, it simply exists. And then other people would argue and say that music has a function, it does something. Now, that thing can change. Some people will listen to certain kinds of music to rile them up, for example, like battle drums. And then some people will listen to other kinds of music to calm them down, like to try to go to bed, like lullabies, some light class, like the harp, for example. So the idea that it's not just one school of thought that exists universally. It could be either or. There is music that simply exists for no purpose other than to exist. And then there is some music that is highly focused. And this sounds like an example. What Dan likes to do is he wants his music to be functional to the point where it serves, as opposed to just being a show. And Dan and I have also talked about where he's not he's an entertainer, not a performer. A performer will just do what they do no matter who's watching, but an entertainer wants to engage their audience. Am I hitting the hammer on that, or am I missing something?
Yes. So for me, just to sit in front of a camera, although I have done it many times, but it was at the request of a friend to record a certain song. Case in point, my buddy John's mama passed away, and he called me on the phone and he said, the next time you make a recording, would you please do Danny Boy for my mom?
Right.
And Danny Boy happens to be my mother's favorite song, and it was mine, and so I did Danny Boy for John. And it comes up on the Facebook memories, and every time, from Ecclesiastes, turn.
Yes.
I did that for a great old friend, and all of his children comment. I put it up every year, you know, on the anniversary of his death, I'll put it up on. And it is that type of music continues to give the gift that keeps on giving. I'm 69 years old. I'll be 70 years old. I can't play football anymore. I rode my last bull. I hope to never ride another bucking horse as long as I live. You know, I can't climb up Thielson again. My shoulders are shot. But I did stand on top of Mount Thielson. I can't hold my breath for 2 minutes underwater any longer like I used to.
Sure.
But I still can play a tune. I'm not the best musician you've ever heard. I'm dang sure not the best guitar player you've ever heard. But in the right set of circumstances, I can almost make you think I am.
Then one more question for you before we're almost out of time, unfortunately, because I could sit here and talk to you all day. Are you basically not taking gig requests right now? So if somebody called you and said, Dan, I'd like you to come play here, you're not taking those kind of gigs right now. Right now, you're mostly just playing wherever you want to.
You know, Muhammad Ali came out of retirement 3 times. I have done gigs here. And usually, I tell when I would do schools, I would do churches, and I would do retirement homes for free in Nebraska. When I came out here, I did get on the circuit of entertaining. I called it landlocked cruise ships. And I would entertain for an hour, and I had 3 different places that I entertained at our show, and I did get paid, so I guess I have no pride, no morals. I will take a check and I will sing a song, but
that's the way it should be, in my opinion. That's why we started the nonprofit, so musicians could make money.
Yep. And so I did
tell, huge part of it.
I said, if you have a request to my audiences, I say my people, I say, if you have a request, just write it on a $20 bill, send it, or a $100 bill. I actually said. If you have a request, write it on a $100 bill and send it to the front. And one old boy did. He wrote a request, Red Wing, and he wrote it on a $100 bill and sent it to the front. And they gave it to me, and I said, next month, you get Red Wing. And I did. And he laughed, and he says, well worth it.
How many songs would you say that you know off the top of your head?
I'm going to say I could reach out and 300.
That's awesome. Well, folks, I really can't say enough about this gentleman, Mr. Dan Smaha, truly a miraculous human being who's conquered a lot of areas and has done a lot of things. We are just about out of time. Dan, is there anything for the audience you'd like them to know before we close?
I just simply would like to put a plug into the Douglas County Music Association and comment on the first concert that was the Dueling Grand Pianos. It wasn't that, but it was the miraculous young musicians out of Eugene, the professionals who tickled the ivories phenomenally well. classical. They Gershwin the duet on Rhapsody in Blue. I was thoroughly entertained because my older sister was trained as a classical pianist and then had a physical issue come in. But so I do appreciate, and by the way, I am a trained musician. I was trained in lower brass instruments, but I had to play that and not sing. Didn't sing a note till I was in college, really.
Dan has given me trombone lessons. He got me an erhu, which is a Chinese-Mongolian two-stringed fiddle. And he also recently donated a mandolin to the nonprofit, which I'm currently getting fixed. That's gonna make it sound a whole lot better. Dan, I really appreciate you in coming on the show today. And I can't thank you enough for taking the time out of your busy schedule to come see us. And if you want to get Dan on your show, or if you want Dan to come play for you, you can send an email to OregonDCMA@gmail.com, and you can request, and I'll put in a good word for you, especially if you're a nice person. But Dan, thank you for coming on the show, and I can't wait to have you back. So, friends and family, welcome to the very last interview of the broadcast. We're going to call this a broadcast, and this is Mr. Jake Tranter with Spider King Studios and Dr. Michael Wheeler of Gene Bechtel School for Music. Gentlemen, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So we're just having a great time, and we're just going to kind of chat a little bit about what our plans are. And I already talked too much, and I think everybody knows that. I started a show where I talk. So, Dr. Wheeler, would you like to go first? What are your summer plans? Do you have camps? Do you have things happening coming up?
Yeah, we're partnering with Umpqua Valley Arts to offer musical day camp programs through Umpqua Valley Arts. We have camps for pre-K kids and a musical theater camp, and it should be tons of fun. Also, some students are like taking the summer to really like hunker down on their technique and musical performance abilities. So we're working with a lot of young people on that stuff. So
now we've been talking a little bit about a lot of summer camps that we want to do. Mm-hmm. Is there anything that the audience should know that's happening down the pipe, or are we still sorting out
certain
details?
Sure, yeah. We're for August 20th, which is a Sunday, at 1 o'clock, we're going to have Fine Arts Day here at Gene Bechtel School for Music in all three of our locations in the Frontier Village Suites. So we'll have things like acting workshops for kids, other fine arts, like should be some like fun painting or visual arts. We haven't quite nailed that down yet. Lots of performance stuff, lots of, again, you know, anytime you ask me to teach anything, we're just gonna be drilling technique constantly. So that's where we're at. But yeah, August 20th. So if you're signed up, for music lessons, look forward to that day, because it should be a lot of fun.
But generally you have good rates for lessons during the summer, during the full year anyway, right?
Yeah, well, we're really pushing our referral program. So any of the current students can refer a friend to sign up with us. Both the person referring and the referred person get 50% off their first month tuition. Yeah.
Okay, so you probably want this audience to know all that.
Definitely,
so
for sure.
If this is somebody who's watched this, if this is the first time you've seen the program, we highly encourage you to come check out the Gene Bechtel School for Music. Some of the finest teachers in the area, especially on the instruments that are listed on the program, including Hindustani music. And if you really want to learn some of that foreign stuff, I recommend coming to Gene Bechtel School, because Dr. Wheeler really, really knows this stuff. Lived in India for a year, right?
Yeah.
Actually, you've traveled
back and forth.
We did our interview a while ago, but I'm forgetting. Yeah. How many different countries have you been to? I'm trying to remember.
I don't remember. I'm sorry.
Like that's how many countries you've been to.
Yeah.
You forgot. Which I can count on one hand how many states that I like being in.
Yeah. Oregon's pretty great.
Oregon and Colorado's fine, I guess.
Yeah.
You know, anyway, that's great. No, thank you for letting us know.
You.
And then Mr. Jake Tranter has been helping me with my broadcast since the very first day. Without Jake, I wouldn't be able to do any of this. He's got the equipment, he's got the time, and the talent with a capital T. Mr. Tranter, what projects are you currently working on, besides mine?
Well, Spider King Studios is really busy. We're doing some really ambitious stuff this year. We're working on 4 feature films for the year of 2024 to be released in 2024. We're working on them this year. So we're doing Killer Roommate, which is a comedy, Pelican Soup, which is a drama.
Right.
We're working on It Calls, which is feeding into that horror genre with H.P. Lovecraft.
I know you like the horror, thriller, slasher stuff.
Yeah.
I know
it's
you're
my
a big
favorite.
Fan. Well, if they're your first 4 movies are horror, thriller, slashers.
And then the last film to wrap up in the fall time will be Hot Autumn, which is going to be our first musical, which Dr. Wheeler, is actually going to be helping us with doing the music supervision of it.
Now, they call us the trifecta. Who's they? I don't know. But because all three of us seem to be part of a tripod leaning in one direction to create and support the arts in Douglas County, all three of us seem to be completely 100% dedicated to this, and we're all doing our own thing separately, togetherly. I know, it's weird. But Jake, that's really awesome. You're really trying to do four movies?
That's the goal.
That is,
yeah.
That is incredible. I know you shoot movies pretty quick.
We usually have a film shoot time of 13-14 days or so. This movie, Killer Roommate, has been taking a lot longer than anticipated, just because of some
we call them logistical errors.
Yeah, logistical errors. Scheduling conflicts, stuff like that. But
right, working with people is hard.
Yeah, but these next films, we're really honing in on the pre-production planning, and we're gonna square it away. We're still gonna get what we want done this year.
Now, are we working towards paid acting gigs, or is it still volunteer only right now?
Oh, that's what we're always working toward, which actually may become a reality this year even. So, if you work with us on our projects, that's just you helping for a better future with us.
And like I said, for the audience at home that's watching this, if you've always wanted to be on stage, if you always wanted to act, Jake Tranter might have a position for you. In fact, I know some people that I've worked with in the past that have already talked about being interested in starring roles, or at least just being on camera, being on film. And Jake's a good director and shoots some pretty good stuff, considering that it's A, Douglas County, and B, this isn't Hollywood. We don't have all of these sets and all of this pre-positioned stuff. And of course, the financing. The financing. If you're out there and you really want to see decent video media being produced, you want to check out Spider King Studios, go to their merch store, buy one of those spider mugs. I mean, I'm actually still planning to get one of those. I'm not even. They have a cute little spider with a crown on his head.
Thank God it's not Hollywood.
Yeah, I have. So, and actually, we've talked about this at quite an extent, but for the audience who doesn't know, our dream, is to somewhat create a new Hollywood. What do I mean by that? Well, it just seems to me that maybe it's not just here, but it seems like the whole world has to go to New York City or Los Angeles to make it in music, art, performance, all that stuff. And it's going to take us a long time, but I would think that maybe Douglas County could do the exact same thing, where at least for the Pacific Northwest, a lot of people want to go to Portland, but Portland's really expensive. Not that it's not expensive down here, but it seems to be more difficult to make enough money to live in Portland than it does to live in Southern Oregon. And there's a lot of talent in this area, and there's no reason why everybody in these small areas should feel like they have to go to LA or New York to be in art and music and media. They should come to where we are. So the three of us together are trying to create new installations where we are the producers of this high quality artistic content, monetarily speaking. So that's kind of the direction that we, all three of us, are moving in. Jake, did you want to tell the audience anything else about your show making or any opportunities coming up?
I guess this is just the year of ambition for us. Something else we have planned is, we want to do short films this year, because we're not releasing this year, we're releasing next year, and we're going to start a momentum of that. But this year, in the month of October, every single day, we plan to release a short film leading up to Halloween night.
Didn't you release a short film with Peyton where she's in the truck?
Mm-hmm.
Is that one of your short films?
For this year, yeah.
Nice, yeah. Okay. Dr. Wheeler, now outside of your current students and your current projects, do you plan to go anywhere or do anything this summer? Are you going to take any time off at all?
No, I'm locked in.
Oh,
you know, yeah. this is a 16-hour venture for me every
right.
day. No, my plan is to...
no horseback riding for you?
No, I don't want to kill
on the open prairie.
The poor horses, if they'd have to support
their me. Their horses are stronger than you think they are.
No, I am practicing this summer. That's my goal.
Now, I always forget, Michael, but your primary instrument is piano, correct?
More or less.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so is that your primary instrument that you'll be studying, or are you going to be just kind of practicing all of your
both,
instruments?
Yeah, piano, diluruba, rabab, and voice.
Oh, I should have grabbed a copy, but Michael Wheeler
I can be
wrote like a college level text on the Esraj, the Dilruba, and the I'm forgetting
Taos.
The Taos. Oh yeah, I don't have any experience on that one.
Yeah.
But so this is an accredited author and composer. He's been in several articles. I'm pointing at Jake, but Dr. Wheeler is
important too.
He's been cited in magazines. He created our Sol-Al chapter, including Spider King and the DCMA with the Sol-Al chapter. And so Dr. Wheeler's got his hands in many pool pockets, as they say. Or is that what they call it, like an octopus?
I've always heard pies.
Pie, yes, many hands.
That always seemed pretty gross
It would seem like you would ruin pies.
I know.
I've got many hands in many different pies. My pie.
Jack,
like, why would we just... Oh, God. Right up, you just picked your nose, too. I saw that. You're just standing there like this, and you're like, ooh, a pie. Very, very good. No, it's figuratively.
Oh, okay.
I was literally being figurative.
I was like, wait, I didn't think that happened. Okay.
I don't even like pie that much. You can have all my pies. I don't particularly care about
pie. I'm on a diet.
Yeah.
The no pie diet is that a... Well, I'm already on that. I'm on that, too. Because a pie's not that good. I don't get pie. What's the big deal?
This conversation went off the rails really fast.
It's the Brocast, and this is what...
I'll take the point.
Yeah, if this was a proper podcast, each of us had like a monster microphone, and we'd be on the couch like this. It would just be like, "Do you? My opinion is like this, you know, man."
Oh yeah, let's talk politics.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that's great.
Okay, but you've been asking us all the questions. What are you doing this summer?
Oh, this isn't about me. But since you asked, I suppose I should. My goal is to do nothing this summer. I teach elementary school, and people don't understand how exhausting it is. Now, I'm not saying that plumbing isn't exhausting, and I'm not saying that building skyscrapers isn't exhausting, or, you know, even directing the Spider Kings or a Jean Bechtel school is not exhausting, but kids all day, every day that aren't yours, and you're constantly dealing with their issues. And again, elementary school teachers don't really get enough credit, to be honest. The things that I see elementary school teachers do, not that high school, middle school teachers don't deserve credit for what they do. Middle school is hard. Give me a break. High school, it's challenging in different ways, but they're mostly sentient and they're mostly more responsible. But little kids, the same oopsies every day, constantly trying to fix behavior, stop hitting him, stop spitting on her, get your fingers out of your nose, all that. And it's exhausting to basically repeat yourself 74 times a day, the basics. You know, stay in your seat, quit doing this, quit doing that. So my goal for this summer, especially the first month off, is to not do anything. My birthday is actually tomorrow, June 15th, and I was going to go fishing, but I'm not feeling it. I don't feel like going out. So I'm just going to stay home and relax on my amazing hammock. My wife got me a hammock for my birthday, which is fantastic.
That's a good woman. Yeah. I just can we appreciate the fact that Mr. Hurwitz just referred to small children as non-sentient?
I said teenagers are more sentient.
Yeah.
Not that little kids aren't sentient, but, you know, it's kind of hard to... having a full-on conversation with a high school student is much easier to do than with the kindergartner. Kindergartners don't make it past, favorite color is brown. Okay, then they just want to go play outside, which is fine with me. Go have fun outside. It is exhausting to watch children do things. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to not doing much. I've got video games to play. I'm going to try to work out a little bit more. I need to get back on the health wagon. And I've been, to be quite frank with this group and this audience, I really do like cold-cut meats. And I am gotta stop.
That's a weakness of mine too.
Pepperoni sticks from Nickabobs. I'm telling. I go to Nickabobs once a week. It's basically my second church, and I worship the gods of the meats. And I just go in and I look at their cuts and I just go, what can I get on?
Worship at the altar of pepperoni.
I get it. It's a good god.
Yeah.
But we're going to be hanging out, and we're going to be doing our clinics August 20th.
Yes.
You definitely want to come see that. Watch for Jake and his film crew. You might see them in downtown or at somebody's apartment filming, and just don't ask any questions. Just remember, they've already talked to the police. Why not? Let's talk about this. So you do a bit where you had to do a car crash, and then you had to talk to like the whole block and the cops and everybody and say, hey, we're doing a scene where we do a car crash. Just for the audience, could you just talk a little bit about having to do all that?
Yeah, that was 2 years ago, Death with Dignity. We filmed in the Hughcrest area here in Roseburg. The plan was to get a permit with City Hall to close down a whole intersection because we were doing this mock car crash scene. And so I had to inform all of the people in the neighborhood by putting, you know, notices in their mailboxes and stuff like that, create a road map plan to divert traffic, stuff like that. So we had barriers at each of these roads, had people in vests to redirect traffic and stuff, not blocking anybody's homes or anything like that.
Right.
But the press came out. We had a small crowd forming around the barricades. No one really interrupted except for some kids. But
yeah, those kids. What are they even doing? It's a school. Go away.
Yeah, but it's fun because as you know, if you're just upfront with your plans, the city usually works with you on that kind of thing.
I do remember doing your Bluebird pizza commercial. They actually want to do more commercials. Have they talked with you about that yet?
Yeah, yeah.
You went to thank you. Because every time I go there, they remember me. They're like, "Here, the guy," and I'm like, "Are you gonna be more commercial?" I'm like, "I don't know. It's up to the director. It's up to you. You want to use? I can go in and buy seconds. I can buy round two. Why not? I'd probably do a lot better job this time." Michael, Dr. Michael, is there anything else for the audience you want them to know about you or your school or anything that's going on?
No. Just if you know somebody who needs music lessons, which hopefully everybody does.
Come see us.
Yes, come see us.
Come see us. Yeah. No, we'd love to have you. We're the best music school in town.
That's right.
We're the only music school in town. Yeah. Well, UCC kind of counts.
Yeah.
They're a music school, but they don't offer the exact same programs that we offer.
That's true.
I mean, they only offer, what is it? It's a two-year degree, right? No matter what you're studying. So we're moving towards diploma programs at the Gene Bechtel School as well. So you'll want to stay tuned for that. Of course, our online learning potential is also developing. We're doing a lot, you guys.
It's true.
I don't even think you appreciate it that much. Just kidding. You guys are great. Jake, anything for the audience before we go?
Yeah, I would say that thank you all for being patient with us. Today is a very busy year, although we aren't releasing a whole lot. But the end of this year leading into next year is going to make for some really busy times for Spider King Studios.
Make sure you check out SpiderKingStudios.com. Buy merch. You can also buy copies of movies they've already made. I recommend getting copies on DVD because I really enjoy having each copy of all the films that he's made. Of course, if you want lessons, check out the Gene Bechtel School for Music, where some of the best rates in town with some of the highest accoladed music teachers that I have met, right? Is that a word?
Yeah,
I hope it is. And then, of course, I'm grateful because I've had the blessing and opportunity to work with these two fine gentlemen since at least October of last year. In fact, Michael and I's story is very interesting. Can I tell the story?
Yeah, please.
This is really fascinating. Now, Michael, please don't be offended. Michael is very easy to offend for the audience who doesn't know. He's incredibly fragile, soft-hearted. No, he's fine.
He can't tell a lie.
No, he's fine. Basically, I have a Facebook page. I think you'd know that by now. Michael sends me a message on Messenger, and the picture that he has, it must have been an older picture because he was like skin and bones. He looked like he was like 20 years old. So I thought Michael Wheeler was messaging me on Facebook being like, "I'm trying to start a school of music. Will you help?" And I just saw this kid, and I was like, "Oh, that's cute. You want to start a school of music? Sure, I'll help you out." And then we agreed to meet up at SLU, and I saw him, and I saw the face, and I was like, "Oh, you don't look 20. You look a little older than 20. Not by much, but just like a little older than 20. And then found out that Michael had been running his own school the whole time and worked at UCC and knew a bunch of people and apparently knew everybody in town already. So I was the dummy in that moment where I made an assumption. I'm like, "Oh, yeah, I'll help this kid out. What are you trying? Oh, your music. Oh, no. You have 7 degrees. Right. Oh."
That picture, for the record, is 3 years old. I've aged about 15 years in the past 3 years.
And, you know, that happens. And you and I have talked about, you know, life happens. And sometimes it just is what it is. And it was just funny to see that picture and then see Michael and be like, "That is not a 20-year-old. That is a seasoned individual right there." And then finding out he'd been running his school the whole time. And then I was just... Then now I've been involved helping him, teaching lessons, or not teaching him lessons. That'd be ridiculous. But learning from him, he's been to my school twice. He taught a lot of Indian instruments, and this year he taught Egyptian instruments, including the rebab, which is for sale. If you're interested in Egyptian rebabs, they're for sale for $50 a piece. And then, of course, without Mr. Tranter's help, all of my videos that I made for my Hucrest kids, he was able to film, including the Hucrest Community Choir videos, which, again, without both of these gentlemen, we couldn't do any of it. To be quite frank, I wouldn't even have the studio space to do the show. I wouldn't have anywhere to teach lessons. So both of you fellas, I really appreciate both of you. And I think, and this is our first season, you guys. So I'm looking forward to season two. And we'll see you guys when we start. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, that seems to be all the time we have left for this season. Tune in next season for an outstanding, exciting show about local art, music, and performance right here in Douglas County, Oregon. I'm Colin Hurwitz, and you've been listening to the WITZ, The Wits, the one place for all of those things right here in your favorite county in the whole state. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next time. Bye, everyone.